morning, good evening, my colleagues. And I would like to thank first Professor Alam for this opportunity, which is timely done, because now we are watching and seeing and hearing about our heritage in Sudan, about our historic buildings in Khartoum, which has been destroyed. So it is high time to talk about it, and it's high time to show at least some of the our heritage in Sudan. And of course, I really see the opportunity to show some of our archaeological sites or some of our archaeological features, at least to the other audience who do not know about our heritage. So I'm going on to talk about how archaeology can support the SDGs. And this is a big topic, and I know that I'm not going to cover it in this 15 or 20 minutes, but I believe that I can give just outlines for what is going on concerning the SDGs. So, and I know that the cultural heritage is under recognized source for sustainable development, which must be leveraged to fully achieve the SDGs. Now, archaeology deals with heritage, which in turn, this heritage supports the environmental quality, education, inclusive economic development, social cohesion, equity, community well-being, and resilience. And this is what I'm going to show in our slides. For sustainability itself, it is one of the five pillars of framework for action on cultural heritage, which highlights its potential to enhance social capital, which boosts economic growth and secure environmental sustainability. Now in this slide, you can see that we are talking about culture and cultural heritage, which can help to achieve inclusive and sustainable development. In this respect, it is very important to mention that ICOMOS, it is an international council on heritage monuments and heritage and sites, sorry, that ICOMOS work for SDG sustainability has started as early as 1964. As the Venice Charter advocated heritage safeguarding for the benefit of future generations. And this focus has increased with 2011 Paris Declaration and the creation of the SDG Working Group in 2015. And all of us know 2015 when the United Nations 2030 Agenda was adopted. So it is at the same time. So we know about sustainability as far as archaeological sites and heritage is concerned long time ago. Now, if I want to say how are sustainability and heritage interconnected, though this is implicit relationship, but many sectors and the stakeholders are not aware of these connections. Now, making this connection more explicit so that we can harness cultural heritage resources and its potential to support sustainable development more effective and to accelerate the implementation of the United Nations Agenda 2030. This relation is actually two ways relationship. So there is an effect that sustainable development or development process has on cultural heritage. Now, in this slide, you can see that the advocating of the role of cultural heritage in the SDGs means to help raise the visibility of cultural heritage sustainable development debates. This includes communicating and advocating the role of heritage at global, at national, and local levels of policy and practice, as well as with academia. Now, heritage for example, heritage for climate action, human rights, the SDG working group, all of this, they are really coordinating with each other and reaching such approaches like climate change and heritage. And this at the end created what is called Climate Heritage Network. Of course, there are other groups like emerging professionals, like culture and nature, like journey, like indigenous heritage, all of these together. They foster our diverse and inclusive approach to cultural heritage and to the SDGs. Now, the next slide. Yes, next slide, please. Yes. So the greenest building. I'm showing here an old photo of the University of Khartoum and no, please go back. What's going on? Go back to the greenest, to number four. Slide number four, please.
Is it not this one?
Yes. Yes, yes, I'm here. I'm in this one.
Yeah.
So, no, please. No. Yes, here. Thank you. Now, the greenest building, heritage buildings, can be adaptively reused So conserving their embodied energy and heritage values, which in turn reduces the carbon footprint of the building sector. They can also be upgraded through the additions of renewables. And here we are covering, for example, SDG 7, 8, 11, and 13, and 17. The photo in the middle is showing the building of the main building of the library of the University of Khartoum. We don't know what is going on there. And the one to the, okay, to my left, Abzaya is from a site called Al Khandak. And this is a two stories building high. You can see this beautiful decoration on the facade of the building. And the other is a drawing of some buildings in the same area. This is showing some of our heritage. Now, next slide. If we want to harness heritage for sustainable, next slide, please. Harnessing heritage for sustainable cities and communities based on the close relationship of cultural heritage with urbanization. Yes. ICOMOS, this International Council on Monuments and Sites, they work closely with UCLG, that is United Cities and Local Government, and Culture Committee. They're partners in Culture 2030 Goal Campaign and with United Nations Habitat. Collaboration on topics such as urban regeneration and climate change. And here the archaeology and archaeological sites are covering the SDGs 11, 13, and 16. There are some of the buildings, the one to the left is the one of the building built by the British. It was in Kuwait in Eastern Sudan. And the middle one is showing Sawakin before its destruction that goes back to the 70s in the Red Sea port. And here, sort of rehabilitation and restoring of one of the buildings in Sawakin to the right. Okay, next. Now, next, please. The cultural heritage promotes creativity and productivity. That is important. The cultural heritage of communities contribute to decent jobs based on local cultural products, traditional arts adopted with innovation to contemporary cultural industries. And here I would like to mention the Faculty of Fine Arts at the Sudan University of Science and Technology. The students there, they have been trying their best and experimenting for a long time which type of mud and silt from the Nile that is used to produce the pottery, the fine pottery of Karma Karsha. Karma Karsha goes back to 2500 BC. So the heritage can create such jobs and create a sort of entrepreneurship for these students. Again, also tourism, on the other hand, promote intercultural understanding of this livelihood. And here we are covering SDG 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and 16. There is another one here. Yes, please, Professor. Yeah, the one next to it. Yeah, next. Now, cultural heritage, yes. Cultural heritage provides well-tested resilience. Here I'm showing some of the archaeological sites. The one on the top is from Karma in Northern Sudan, and to the left is from, no, please, back, yes. And to the left is from Bedrawiya. It is a site which has been nominated at the cultural heritage sites, and now it is one of the cultural heritage sites from 2003. Now, it will provide well-tested resilience. The resilience of historic places, this validates the importance of traditional knowledge, quality of historic materials, and enduring nature of the culture. Heritage places are both threatened by climate change and a resource in adaptation and mitigation for it. And here we are covering SDGs 4, 11, and 13. Now, well-maintained heritage is also very important in addressing risk related to natural and human-made disasters, like what we are having today, the war that is going on in Sudan, besides, of course, the environmental effects. Experience has shown how the degradation of natural resources, neglected rural areas, urban sprawl, and poorly engineered new constructions increase the vulnerability of the communities to disaster risk, especially in poorer countries. On the other hand, a well-conserved natural historic environment based on traditional knowledge and the skills considerably reduces underlying disaster risk factors, and it strengthens the resilience of the communities and saves the lives. World heritage, of course, like the one I'm showing now, one of the world heritage in Marawi, is of course also essential to the spiritual well-being of people for its powerful symbolic and aesthetic dimensions. Next, please. Next. Now, cultural heritage empowers vulnerable groups, protecting the tangible and intangible cultural heritage means protecting associated communities like indigenous people. You can see here to the right, the one who is in the lower slide is a man in Bajrawiya area who is selling his products and his commodities to the tourists who arrive there. Culture and heritage bring people together, fostering social cohesion and peace for all. At times of crisis, moreover, access to and the care for heritage may help vulnerable people to recover the sense of continuity. This is what we are lacking today, the sense of continuity, the dignity and empowerment. In conflict, like what we have now and post-conflict situations in particular, we have to acknowledge and conserve the heritage. This is based, of course, on shared values and interests and may foster mutual recognition, tolerance, respect among different communities, which is precondition for society's peaceful development. And in this case, we are covering SDGs 10, 11, 14, 15, and 16. Next slide, please. The cultural heritage is a knowledge and education resource. Immeasurable knowledge accumulated over centuries. No back, please. Yes. And transmitted through generations is involved in heritage sites and communities. So education that draws on cultural context, no, the next please, cultural context of its resources has more impact that empowers us through better understanding. And here we are dealing with 11 and 16 from the SDGs. Now the people, the planet, and their prosperity and the culture where literate exists help people to realize that there is value in other cultures and instill a sense of unity among humankind in general. Next slide, please. Cultural heritage, please, next one. Now the cultural heritage is a strength in a country. It defines its citizens, the shared identity, and makes the land an attractive place to live, defines our identity. The diversity of heritage also allows regional identities to thrive, supporting human dignity, peace, security, and well-being. The next slide. Yeah, this is showing, this slide showing in the top, it is one of the tombs of the saints of the sheikhs who were really venerated in Sudan, sanctified actually, and it is in Eastern Sudan. They are having these colorful flags on the top of the burial. And at the bottom to the left is a scene from one of the burials of the Medwetic that is in Madrawi area that dates back to seven and five, to between 7 and 5 centuries BC. And the one to the left is from Christian period in the Sudan, showing the mural drawings. Okay, next. Next, please. Yes. Then acknowledgement and conservation of the diversity of cultural and natural heritage and the fair access to it and the equitable sharing of the benefits deriving from its use enhance the feeling of place and belonging, mutual respect for others and the sense of purpose and ability to maintain in common a common good which contribute to the social cohesion of the community as well as to individual and collective freedom of the choice and action. There is, okay, can you just press one? There is one that should be shown in this slide. I would just would like to show another side of the country's story that we are having these dome tombs for the saints. And we believe, yes, we believe in them. And we believe that they can help you even after their death and their, yeah. And also I'm showing some of the tomb stones showing how people have been also practicing calligraphy and writing. And some of the products like this ablution pitcher to the right, which is made out of mud. So it is a pot made out of mud. And in the middle, we are having this slate where the students in the Khalwa, that is Quranic school, they study and then they write on these slates to memorize the Quran. So here in this case we need to understand that we need the cohesion of the community and we need to acknowledge the existence of everyone in this community. The ability to access and to enjoy and to enjoy and care for one's heritage is essential for what Nobel Prize winner Amartya Sen calls the capability of individuals to live and to be what they choose. That is fundamental component of human development. And with this, we are covering SDG 4, 5, 8, 10, 11, 12, and 16. Now, the last slide, the climate and human adaptation is a major research topic in archaeological theory and practice. So I'm now moving from the heretic, from the sustainable development in heretic to another topic, which involves scientific research. The climate and human adaptation is a major research topic in archaeological theory and practice. And for us in Africa, it is on sub-Saharan areas that has increasing impact, and in particular on vulnerable people. So how do archaeologists contribute to sustainable development goals in this respect? In the other side, we have already talked about the sites and their development and their importance for the local community and for attraction of tourism and all these things. Now we need to know how can we benefit from the past evidence to improve the present, to prepare for the future. One of the things that archaeologists have been dealing with is food security, climate resilient systems. How can we create these climate resilient systems, and how we can adapting our own food systems to climate change? What the role, for example, of women in agricultural practice? We know that there were many, many women practicing cultivation and agriculture. So we also need to elaborate a little bit in indigenous knowledge and technologies and how this could help, especially now in the time of war in Sudan with a shortage in electricity. They should go back to the wheelchair, the sagia, for example. We believe that archaeology provides examples of the past that can increase yield productions. We have been telling our students about different lessons from the past, in different parts of the world. How, for example, they have been trying for the potatoes in South America for the Maya and Inca areas, and how they have brought them and the new technology to support them in cultivating the potatoes, and how that is failed, and when they get back to the system that had been practiced before, the yields was very much and was amazing. So, and also we need to talk about how to make some areas a hub for producing crops that go beyond political borders. And with this, I mean that we are having research in Eastern Sudan, and we have colleagues in Ethiopia, for example, who are doing some research concerning, for example, sorghum. And if we can create a sort of a hub or part of the centers of excellence in these parts, and then we can at least share together the results of this research, and also we can help in increasing the yield of such crops which would help the people in their living. Again, some of the stuff we are discussing, the water problems for human use and adaptation to difficult and acute and severe situations. In Sudan, we know that people adaptation to climate in their household organization, and even in the material they are using in the north, for example, and also in the recycling of agricultural residue and the use of palm leaves, for example, for various purposes. And another thing concerning this scientific research is how has archaeology accurately told us about climate change, for example. A lot of research can help in contextualizing current and future climate change, the use of archaeological models to predict the impact of future climate. The change can help us to prepare for climate ahead, not just to look back. We look back and we see what the climate has done for the fall of some civilizations, and then we can get lessons from that. Now, an important thing is that we need to look at the case of the impact of climate change on archaeological sites, on river and desert, on coastal areas. This is for us, for example, in Africa. What have archaeologists discovered about climate change in prehistoric and historic Sudan, for example? So all these are questions that scientists are studying and doing some research about it. And it is showing now how archaeology can help in that respect. Besides, of course, many other disciplines, even in medical field. Now, my final remarks is that partnership in action for the goals, the 2030 agenda for sustainable development, can only be achieved together in partnerships, multi-actor, multi-sector platform within and outside these heritage sectors. For example, the UNNG major group, UNESCO, the United Nations Habitat, and on all the other organizations I mentioned in the first and the second slides. And here we are covering sorry, SDG 11 and 17. Now, we have examples of heritage integrated with sustainable development. Cultural and natural heritage are connected in many heritage sites. So cultural heritage is affected sometimes under the threats of inappropriate or unsustainable development, but at the same time, it affects the development because cultural heritage, when protected and managed in optimal way, it actually makes for better sustainable development. The more you protect heritage, the more sustainable you become. The fragility, the vulnerability of heritage should be overcome. It should be supported with more funding, with policy, with awareness. Thus, sustainable development is strengthened by cultural heritage. The world will help itself if it helps the cultural heritage protection. There are certain attempts by the ICOMOS and by the UNESCO for leveraging cultural heritage as a policy tool, and they produce policy analyses and outreach documents to inform stakeholders and educate people on heritage issues and solutions. The ICOMOS, they have their guiding document, which include in 2016, concept note, and in 2017 they have action plan information on their SDG policy guidance in development, which covers SDG 4, 11, and 16. The UNESCO also have its SDG policy, which provide guidance for management of heritage sites with regard to society, economy, environment, and peace. So this is as far as heritage is concerned. Now for scientific research in climate change, in other topics I have just referred to, the cooperation across borders for innovation solutions to promote resilience, prosperity, and competitiveness, and of course, economic and social well-being. We need to accelerate the transition of our countries, like in my country, Sudan, to innovation-led, knowledge-based economies, which cannot be achieved without mushrooming the SDI across socio-economic sectors, nor without addressing the challenges like the food security or access to water or energy, effective health systems, and above all, creating what we call it continental education for Africa. Thank you very much. Thank you.